Full day yesterday with a series of presentations, discussions. We'll keep the same format. We have two sessions this morning. And so without much ado, I suggest we get started. I'm calling upon those in the back there to come over, come in. And very good, Michelle, all yours.
Great, good morning. It's great to see all of you here. I'm Michelle Wooker. I'm president of the World Policy Institute, and I teach here at SEPA. And our panel this morning is going to be on policy impacts on job creation, particularly from regional perspectives. I believe that some of the members of the World Bank team wanted to pose a couple of questions to the group ahead of the panel. Oh, here you guys are.
Okay, thanks. My name is Gordon Betjeman, and I'm part of the World Bank team. The first session today is on the policy part of the report. And the policy framework that the report has is an important part of pulling it all together for us. And you may recall when Martin gave the presentation yesterday, we have what we call a policy pyramid, which has three different layers in it, which together we talk about as policies through the job lens. And the first part of that pyramid is essentially the fundamentals, the sorts of things that you need in order to have strong growth, and we make a point of including protection of rights in that first layer of the fundamentals. Really what's new about the report is the second and third parts of the pyramid. And the middle part of the pyramid, which we call labor policies, this is the plateaus and cliffs that we talked about yesterday. And if you recall, the storyline with respect to our plateaus and cliffs metaphor is that after reviewing a lot of the literature on the impact of different labor institutions, things like labor laws and collective bargaining arrangements and social insurance programs, we came to the conclusion that most countries operate within a fairly broad zone that we call the plateau. And a lot on that plateau, there's redistributive things going on. And there might be modest efficiency and employment effects going on, but in most countries that we looked at, it is probably not the major obstacle to the creation of jobs and good jobs for development. It doesn't mean this is not important, because if you get off the plateau onto one of these cliffs, at either side, too much regulation and distorting collective bargaining agreements and so forth, or on the other side, less visible but equally important, where there's not access to mechanisms for voice or access to social protection instruments, then we argue that this can have serious consequences for a country's jobs challenge. So that's one innovation we think about the policy framework. The second, and this hopefully we'll get a chance to talk about today, is the top part of the pyramid that we call priorities. And this is where we really focus on the concept of the good jobs for development, the jobs that in a specific country situation may have positive development payoffs, either in terms of living standards or productivity and social cohesion. And it's in this priorities area that we think there are a lot of very interesting policy options to consider. And these policies can go well beyond the labor market. In agrarian economies, it may well be agricultural policies. In other types of countries, it very well could be urbanization policies. So this really broadens the scope of what we think about in terms of thinking about policies through the job lens. Last thing before I stop, in all of these areas, what we've really tried to do in this report is go beyond the formal wage employment sector. Okay, so a big priority in the report is to think about how these policy options work in an environment in developing countries, which, as we talked about yesterday, at least half of the people who are working are in fact not in work forms that we characterize as wage employment. Thanks.
Great, thank you. I'll introduce each of our panelists ahead of their own particular talk. They'll each go on for about 10 minutes, and then we'll open it up to the room. Our first speaker this morning is John Haltwanger. He's a distinguished university professor in the Department of Economics at the University of Maryland. He's also been at UCLA and Johns Hopkins. He's a research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research and a senior research fellow at the Center of Economic Studies at the U.S. Census Bureau, where he previously served as chief economist. His work focuses on firm-level job creation, job destruction, and economic performance. And he's explored the implications of these dynamics for U.S. productivity growth and for the U.S. labor market, and I think that's what he's going to talk about today.
Great. So it's great to be here. I had the privilege of sort of watching this the WDR team go through this process in the last year and met with them on a number of occasions. Can I say, I think they did I'm sure this probably came up recently. They did a fantastic job. I thought it was very interesting to sort of see the transformation over time. What kind of struck me, it's as though, obviously they were writing a book with about 150 referees, and all of which had different opinions. And so somehow or another, they managed, and I think quite nicely, to produce a very nice and coherent report. So I'm going to talk about some of the themes. So this is supposed to be a policy session. I'm going to be more about challenges to policy. I feel like I'm better at that than telling you what makes sense and what to do. And kind of from my perspective. And some of these themes were very very much touched on in the report. So there's really going to kind of there'll be basically two or three points I'm going to try to make in my 10 minutes. So one theme in the report. One thing that's critical, for job creation is job destruction. That is, and why is that? So I want to talk briefly about why that is. Well, one thing we've discovered, I think, for literally every country that we've looked at that's quite important inside, every industry in every country is allocative efficiency. That what we see in every country and inside in this every industry, lots of dispersion in productivity and lots of dispersion in size. And those are exactly the ingredients that if that gets screwed up, if there's misallocation, you can have very poor performance. You will be an industry or an economy where nobody wants to buy those goods because indeed they're not very productive, they're high cost, they're not high quality kinds of goods. And so a critical thing in an economy is to constantly be pushing to move resources jobs literally to their highest value. And you can only do that if you not only have obviously job creation but also job destruction and entry and exit. And the challenge for policy, of course, I don't think this is so new to economists, is lots and lots of things can go wrong. And the report does a great job, I'd say, of talking about all those kinds of challenges. So let me motivate with my own kind of cut on this. And so here's a very simple exercise we did for the United States. We did this for the U.S. manufacturing sector. We took every U.S. manufacturing plant. And we gave them, this is a simulation exercise, we basically said we're going to figure out what the distribution of productivity is and the distribution of size. And instead of actually having size and productivity be allocated in the way it actually is in the data, we're just going to randomly allocate size across productivity. If you did that today, this morning, in the United States, we would productivity would plummet in the United States. So indeed, a key thing that's going on in the United States, indeed, is that we're allocating resources, at least on average, relatively efficiently. All right? Now, what we've seen around the world is that when countries go through market reforms, they improve this covariance between size and productivity. And again, this is a theme that has shown up in the report. So in the Eastern European economies, I'm just going to go through this very quickly. In the Eastern European economies in the 1990s, this covariance between size and productivity rose essentially in every one of these countries. In Colombia, when it went through its market reforms in the 1990s, this covariance between size and productivity rose substantially. China, as it's gone through tremendous market reforms, the covariance between size and productivity has risen. I know I'm going through this very quickly. I should note that formally, And if you're interested, I can, you can contact me and find the papers and the information. I'm using a decomposition that Ali and Pecas developed way back in 1996. And so in all of these charts, what I'm showing you is the Ali-Pecas covariance term, which is basically a summary measure of the covariance between size and productivity. Now, the only way you can get these covariances to move, or indeed you could sort of say, is indeed for there to be job creation and destruction. And one of the early charts in the WDR says job creation and destruction is ubiquitous. So you say, well, look, if that's true, are all countries doing this? And the answer is no. Job creation and destruction is a necessary but hardly a sufficient condition for this to work. And again, the WDR talks quite nicely about this. So to use I'm going to use for the next two slides the kind of the U.S. as a benchmark, and then talk about the rest of the world. The U.S. you could say has a remarkably high rate of job creation and destruction. So this is the annual rates of creation and destruction. And so the way to interpret this statistic, the 16.9, it says, if you go from one March to the next and you ask what fraction of jobs weren't there 1 year prior, it's like 17% of U.S. jobs. And if you ask the opposite question, if you go from one March to the next and you ask what fraction of jobs were there one March and aren't there the next March, that's 15.3%. And so it's an incredibly high rate of creation and destruction. And you can also see entry and exit play an important role. And as the WDR talked about, This kind of creative destruction, in some sense, you could say, you know, what early on when we saw these kind of statistics, we thought, okay, maybe the problem is that in some countries this is just not happening. But no, actually, you kind of see everywhere job creation and destruction. The problem is, in many ways, it's not necessarily productivity enhancing. It's not moving resources away from less productive to more productive businesses. Now, you could say the comments I'm making, you know, they're so basic. They're kind of what we teach our principal students in economics. We talk about allocative efficiency, allocating resources to their highest valued use. That's all I'm talking about. If you say that to policymakers, policymakers say, of course, that's what we want to do. But then the hard part here is if destruction is a key part of this, it's not surprising that policymakers rightfully get very nervous about this idea, okay, we need to open up our markets. And as was nicely said here, it's not just worrying about labor market policies, it's working about product market policies, product market and credit market policies, and you know, obviously trade reform and all the rest. So lots of things can go wrong in this process. Now, one thing that can go wrong are labor market policies. So in work that we have done, we have found actually that if you have highly distorted labor regulations, you stifle this creative destruction process. So there is a systematic relationship between having distorted labor market regulations and this creative destruction. So I do want to sort of say that there is something going on in terms of the magnitude, but you need to be careful about how you think about that. We do see creative destruction everywhere. But indeed, you can distort the magnitude. But I also want to emphasize it's not just distorting the magnitude, it's distorting the nature of the creative destruction process. So again, I want to sort of say, you know, policymakers get, you know, when organizations like the World Bank go into countries and say, you know, kind of give them the usual blueprint for opening up their markets for all the kinds of market reform, many of which are talked about, have been talked about for years and are talked about in this report, I'll say they're nervous about the following. And I'm going to use the U.S. as an example, because you could say the U.S. in principle is one of the least distorted, although it's clearly has its own source of distortions. And by the way, this is a chart that did show up in the WDR as figure 8.7. So those of you who read it carefully, this is figure 8.7. So what is this? This is the quarterly job creation and destruction rates in the United States. The point the WDR emphasized, which I also want to emphasize, is that in times, you could say, of recessions, and particularly I'll say, you know, and the last one is a doozy of a recession, obviously, it's a crisis. What makes policy makers nervous is when creation and destruction get decoupled, all right? And And decoupling is just a very simple idea. What I think policymakers are nervous about is, okay, maybe when I open up my markets, or more generally when I have a crisis, lots of jobs get destroyed. And if the social planner was reallocating resources, when you have a lot of destruction, you ought to have a lot of creation at the same time. So every model you write down in terms of allocative efficiency, if you have a burst of destruction, you should have a burst of creation. But you can see, let's use the Great Recession as the example here. This was a time in which destruction spiked, but creation plummeted. And you can also see in the post-recovery period, the problem in the United States is not the destruction is high. It's actually lower. There's a downward trend. We could talk about that if we wanted to, but that's not the theme of today's remarks. Destruction is actually much lower than the pre-crisis period. It's creation that's just so anemic. So why is the U.S. labor market so anemic? We're just not creating jobs. And I think it's, you could sort of say this kind of dynamic is even worse in more distorted economies. And it's going to be the case in economies in which this kind of decoupling go on. And again, this is almost a tautology. If you have highly decoupled creation and destruction, what are you going to have? Incredibly high rates of unemployment. Because indeed, you're going to have lots of destruction, not much creation. What are those people going to do? They're either going to be unemployed or, as in the WDR, they're going to be underemployed in the informal economy. So I'm going to stop here. I have not offered any guidance on the policy pyramid and so on. What I have said in terms of, you could say, good jobs for development is worrying about allocative efficiency is critical. And let me close on that remark. You might sort of say, well, is this something I just need to worry about for the advanced economies? Is it just if you're at the frontier you need to have all this turbulence and all this turning? And the answer is, I say, no, the evidence overwhelmingly suggests no. That indeed every country we've looked at, and I'll say it, all stages of development, inside narrow industries and countries, there's enormous dispersion in productivity and performance across businesses. And so if you're screwing up the allocation across such businesses, you are going to have a poorly performing economy, both on productivity and job growth. So I'll stop there.
Thank you. We'll take questions at the end after all of the panelists together. Elizabeth Osletic could not make it today at the last minute. So our next speaker is Clara Sabiyanova-Peter. She's an assistant professor and William R. Cannon Jr. Fellow at the Department of Economics and Fellow of the Carolina Population Center at the University of North Carolina. Her work focuses on the behavioral responses of individuals and firms to public policies in a weak institutional environment, generally transitional economies. She's looking at research at the crossroads of labor and public economics. She's done a lot of work on the Russian economy. Previously, she was at Georgia State University, at the University of Michigan Business School, and was the Dean of International Affairs at the School of Economics at Ural State University in Russia. So she'll be talking today about transitional economies.
Thank you very much for the introduction. So I was asked to comment on, I was asked to comment on a report from the regional perspective, and in particular from the perspective of former centrally planned economy, former transition economies, and I don't know how to call them now anymore. So countries that have a common historical background, and still have very common issues in terms of the job creation and labor market policies. So, of course, there are many issues in this part of the world, and I chose the issues that is related to my academic research and chose the three tweets that I'm going to comment on about the informality, about the labor policies that matter less than assumed, and one size does not fit all. First of all, I really like the idea of the report of trying to classify countries based on some of the features of the labor markets, which are not related just to simply, for example, colonial origin or location. But on the other hand, while thinking of transition economies, so I realize many of them will enter a very different dimensions in the chart in the World Development Report. Some of them would be classified as aging, like, for example, Poland. Some of them will be classified as resource-rich. And there is really very hard to classify them now together because maybe their path had diverged. And the only really classification that I found possibly can be combined them is a formalizing. And I put a question mark because I believe that this term is actually quite ambiguous, and I would like to comment on that. So first of all, in the report, the informality is defined based on the extensive margin. So mostly the informality is defined based on the, for example, lack of firm registration, lack of social security coverage, or lack of employment contract. And if you, from this perspective, you can look at transition economies and say, yes, they're pretty formalized. Most of the workers actually work in the formal sector. So, for example, if you take Russia from 2011, only 6% of respondents in the National Household Survey reported that they did not work officially according to the labor contract. Moreover, 43% of them said this was their own decision or this was a joint decision with the employer. So the issue here is that this kind of definition approach to informality does not cover extensive margin of informality, because the key problem in the transition economies is not the binary dimension of informality, but intensive margins. So there is significant, actually, size of informal sector in Russia and many transition economies. For example, in the same 2011 household survey, 18% of formal employees believe that their employers do not pay their salary officially. Moreover, among those 18%, the average proportion of unofficial income avoided for tax purposes and not reported for Social Security benefits is 80%, and that is a big number. So the government also acknowledges that informal sector is quite large. So, for example, in national income and product accounts in Russia, 28% of employees' income is counted as a separate line in NIPA as hidden earnings. So in household survey, you will see there is also a significant gap between what people report their assets are, their consumption are, and how much they report earnings. And that's a household survey based on which we later are going to use and evaluate the labor market policies. For example, if you look at the 20-year history in Russia, the consumption and income gap in the household survey is about 20-30%. Exists, and that's quite significant. We cannot believe that the savings at this rate can exist for a 20-year period. So what's the implication of that? The implication actually for policies are quite important. First of all, those unofficial earnings are not eligible for unemployment insurance. They're not eligible for Social Security contributions. They're not eligible for credit market applications. So you have countries which are mostly formalized according to the binary definition of informal economy, but they have a huge informal sector. The policy effects based on the observed earnings and observed income distributions are going to be misleading. And there are a number of papers, actually recent papers, that have shown that there is a huge differential effect when we look at the effect of policies on the observed outcomes like observed wage distribution versus true productivity, like, for example, looking at the asset distribution or looking at the consumption distribution. So in a number of my papers as well, so we have shown that the effect of personal income taxes policies had a opposite effect on the distribution of earnings and on the productivity effect versus reported earnings effect. For example, as a result of the Russian flat tax policy, the reported earnings has increased while the consumption effect did not change much. And this has affect how we're going to interpret the social welfare gains. So are we going to look at them in terms of what we observe in the data, or we can evaluate them from the actually truly increase in social welfare effects as a result of the reforms? There are also recent papers that look at the minimum wage policies that also separate that. So one way, for example, in the report, it says that the minimum wages, for the most part, is found to have an increasing effect on to increase the wages and to reduce the wage distribution. The problem is, again, this looks at the observed reported income. So this paper, they showed that the minimum wage policies have, in transition economies, have actually increased the size of the informal sector, and they also change the overall distribution of earnings, and that's also very important to look. So this leads to another question, which is the plateau effect, which I find is very useful. And actually, the plateau effect, and especially when I see that the actual effects are different at the cliffs versus the plateau. Then as a labor economist, I started thinking, why is that most of studies today find that most of the labor market policies have a very zero or insignificant effect on various outcomes? The question is here, of course, is zero actually, is a true zero? So, and then there are a number of reasons why it may not be the case. So first of all, and I would like to at least comment on three issues here. So distributional effects, partial equilibrium effects, and data effects. So first, the distributional effects. There is a number of studies in the recent literature. So for example, in the United States, there was a paper in AR by Bittler and Hoynes that shows that there is a significant differences in the treatment effects of the U.S. welfare programs across percentiles of income distribution. They find that on average, the effect is zero. But if you look at the distributional effects, you will see in some parts of the distribution, the effect is highly positive. In some parts of distribution, is highly negative. Similar in my paper, when we look at the, again, at the effect of the tax policy on the labor supply, we found that in Russia, the overall labor supply elasticity with respect to wages and with respect to tax rates is very negligible on average. But as soon as we look at the distributional effects, we find that actually it matters. It matters where the policies has been targeted for. It matters where hours are flexible. It matters where workers have a part-time jobs. It matters at the bottom of the income distribution. So again, but on average, what we get a pretty much insignificant effect that people can interpret that actually the policies do not matter. So I think this seeming contradiction between the insignificant results in academic research and the heated policy debates deserve a special attention. So because, I mean, on one hand, as academics, we can say, okay, so maybe it's just policymakers don't read academic research, and therefore they don't know that actually policies don't matter. So, but on, you know, but on the other hand, maybe we can actually think about, you know, why there's this heated debate exists. Like in the recent years about the minimum wage in the United States, there was battles between groups of economists. So, so, I mean, of course, distributional effects one thing, but also we have to think about maybe this comes actually from the data, from the way how we model things. Because so we can acknowledge that most of the empirical models, they're partial equilibrium models. So the goal is to cleanly identify the causal effect of the policy on some outcomes, to get rid of everything else and just to look at the net effect. But from the policy perspective, the gross effect is also important. It's important how the policies interact with other factors. So it's important whether or not we look at the short-term effects or at the long-term effects. And in the short-term effects, the policies can maybe have insignificant results, but in the long-term, they can have a much more effective estimated outcomes. I also would like to mention that in today econometrics, as an empirical economist, I can say it's much easier to find zero. Why? Because there are just so many methods that actually simply, yes, they're designed to find the consistent estimate of policy effects on outcomes. But on the other hand, many of these methods also inflate standard errors. And if the sample design is not accurate, if the sample data, if the sample size is very small, finding zero is actually is very easy. And yes, there are some literature that refers that it's very easy to publish paper that shows significant results. But I think in today's world, it's actually reversed. Today, it's very easy to show that sometimes policy was significant in the past is found, and now it's actually the result of zero. So if we account for clustering, you know, at the location size, we want to account for outer correlation, we want to account for heteroscedasticity, we want to use fixed effect, all of those methods. So at the end, inflate the standard errors. The question is how we are going to separate here the true zero in the population versus estimated zero that comes from the data outcomes. So I think it's a very important issue, and I think it's important to actually separate the studies based on, so what kind of sample they use, what kind of data they use. So it just because this contradiction is between the results in research and the policy debate, it seems still unexplored to me. So it's not clear, you know, why is that most of the research shows today very little effect of economic policies. I know I don't have a time anymore. I have two more comments to say, right? So what I'm going to say, this is actually related to transition economies. One more comments, maybe without showing the numbers that I have here. I mean, it's quite natural that, for example, for development economies to focus on issues that are constraining. For example, insufficient schooling, insufficient training. So, and I totally agree with the point that, for example, it's not just the number of jobs. But schooling is also important, and I would like to say here it's not just the years of schooling. So why? Because in transition economies today, so again, looking at the pure statistical data, you will find that those economies are doing great. So for example, most of the transition economies are outliers today in terms of the tertiary education enrollment. Russia, for example, has the highest rates of high school graduates who enter the college among all OECD countries. So within the last 15 years, the college enrollment went up by 30 percentage point. And of course, you can say this is just basically like a paradise. So it's a great number statistically. And do we really care about these issues? But I say that it's actually quite important from the policy perspective. So the outcomes of this, what we observe in the data, is a declining returns to schooling, is increased mismatch between jobs and skills. But moreover, there is a huge disbalance across sectors and across majors. For example, if you see the country where you have 80% of population is now of the school age population from 18 to 22, 80% of population is enrolled in college. So then the question is where they go and why this is important politically. So why? Because if you look at the distribution where people go, so you will find that, for example, people who go to majors like nuclear engineering or spacecraft or aircraft, so these people come from the bottom part of the ability distribution. So you may say, because, I mean, it's natural, the labor economics predicts us, so that people should go to the fields where they have a higher returns to schooling, and they go to management fields. So, or other fields with a higher returns to schooling. The problem is 20 years in a row, this would be not only a country issue, it's going to be a global issue, where people go, because these are people who are going to be engineers in the nuclear plants. These are people who are going to be pilots. So the problem is, I don't know, is there a place for government for this kind of issues? I believe there is, because this disbalance is going to have effect 20 years in a row into the quality of the workforce that the country has, okay? So so I'm going to finish at this, so I just all address 3 points, but I think, so for now it's enough, so maybe I will comment later when I have opportunity, okay, thank you.
Thank you, I'm definitely gonna have some questions, and I bet the rest of the room has too. It's really, really interesting. Our next panelist is Miguel Urquiola, who is Associate Professor of International and Public Affairs and Economics and Vice Dean at the School of International and Public Affairs here. His research focuses on education policy in the developing world and in Latin America in particular. So that closing comment on education was a very nice segue. He studies educational markets. He's a research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research and co-editor of the Journal of Human Resources. He has held appointments at the Russell Sage Foundation, Cornell University, the World Bank, the Bolivian government, and Bolivian Catholic University. And he'll be talking about beyond labor policies in Latin America, jobs, human capital, and social cohesion.
Thanks very much. Thanks for having me. And thanks for having me at this very interesting meeting. I really enjoyed looking at the jobs report, and I'll try to say something that, as was previewed, might be related to education and stuff like that. So anyhow, my task is to speak about policies, to speak somewhat about the regional aspect, and I'll say some things about Latin America, and then I'll also say something about human capital, since that's basically what I do research on. So the issue that was mentioned is that one of the focuses, of course, of this report is to look at policies. And the way I'd like to frame this comment, basically, I only have one comment, which is there's this nice pyramid of what's going on there. And one of the issues that I actually want to focus on is the fundamentals. So one of the fundamentals, you know, there are four fundamentals listed there. I'll speak about human capital. And these are all things that we think really are necessary for a country to sort of to grow, for basically productivity to go up, and so on and so forth. In a way, the report, and I think this is reflective of the way that economists usually do work, sort of says, well, you know, we won't deal very much with the fundamentals because everyone understands those are there, and we're going to deal mainly with either the middle or the top. And by contrast, many people who work on education, perhaps myself most of the time, think, well, I'm just dealing with human capital, and I'm not going to worry about jobs. And the point basically is that if we focus on human capital as something that is desirable, that a country ultimately needs, then the link between jobs and human capital becomes very important. And basically the general notion is, why do people invest in education? And this is something that came up in the previous comments. Why did we, all of us in this room, have lots of schooling, right? Why did we go to school and work hard? This gets back to points Martin made yesterday on sort of human agency. Why did we work hard and make an effort? Well, because we saw some link that if I do this, something will happen for me in the future. I'll have a more interesting life. I'll have more income. I'll have a more fun life, perhaps. So if I go to school, if I work hard, then something will happen. And something happening is, as Martin mentioned, in a large extent related to, you know, do I have a better job? Is my job interesting? Does my job pay me income? And so on and so forth. So the point I'd like to dwell on is basically trying to link these two things, and I will use examples from Latin America. Now let me start by emphasizing once more that frequently we see these things as separated. And I'm going to jump around a little bit in my slides, and actually let me go to my final slide, which is citing the World Development Report in 2004. So that report asked itself, how might we improve public service delivery, which is basically one of the ways in which we get one of the fundamentals, which is human capital. And the report basically had a position which I think is quite standard in economics, that basically what is failing the production of human capital in many countries, certainly Latin America, is that there is not a clear market-type relationship between the consumer and the producer. So it basically says poor people have a relationship when they buy something in the market, such as a sandwich. They get the service because they can basically hold the provider accountable. And basically, this does not happen when people go to school, for example, or buy schooling from public schools. And because there's not that thing going on, then, you know, that is why we don't have human capital production. And of course, the implication from this, which is a very standard one, which perhaps was first articulated by Milton Friedman, is just say, well, then maybe what we should do is introduce more competition and liberalization into the educational sector. That will take care of the first of one of the four fundamentals listed there. It'll produce large human capital or good human capital, and then from then on we go on to job creation. Okay. So because I was asked to say something from the regional perspective, let me cite one country which is interesting in Latin America, and certainly one of the most successful in Latin America, which is Chile. Okay? And I basically want to use what Chile did to basically think about this pyramid. So Chile has had exemplary economic policies generally. Right? It's a country that we think that I think we correctly think is very well managed, and also I think is a country that illustrates at least at a gut level for an economist, that really liberalizing and sort of letting the market have a big role, clear rules and so on and so forth, can raise productivity, can do all sorts of good things. Now, Chile also tried this way of doing things in education. So in 1981, Chile introduced essentially what Milton Friedman had suggested, which is an unrestricted voucher scheme. Basically, it says every kid gets a voucher, and the kid can use that voucher at a private school. This has induced a very large private sector, and most kids, 94% of kids nowadays, go to voucher-funded schools, and more than half go to private schools, most of which operate for profit. Okay, so this is kind of, you would say, if a country wants to get that fundamental right, then maybe this is the way to go. Now, if you ask me what my assessment of what this produced in Chile is, and I don't think this is such a controversial assessment, actually, it produced two things. One, huge stratification, meaning that basically, you know, the rich go to school with the rich, the not-so-rich with the not-so-rich, and so on and so forth. So basically, if you can tell me in the microdata of Chile which school a kid goes to, you're basically telling me that kid's household income. Okay? So maybe that's not surprising. We know from much theoretical work that educational markets have a tendency to stratify. But the other thing which is interesting is that this basically produced little improvement in skills in at least one measure of human capital which we have, which is, say, test scores. Okay, so Chile has slightly performed in international test scores, but it's still well within the bounds of sort of Latin America, which is pretty dismal in terms of human capital. So we might say, you know, this first part of the pyramid is not working well. Now, that's my assessment, right? You might not believe me. We could also ask the current president of Chile what his assessment is. And this was in some State of the Union or State of the Country speech which he gave. He said, our educational system, let's say it plain and simple, does not give everyone quality education. Far from correcting social inequality, it often perpetuates it across generations. So one thing that, and here I have a picture of some student riots in which, you know, Chile has been dealing with, you know, again and again over the past few years. If I look at the Chilean market, what is one thing that that is basically gone? That there has been huge educational expansion, right? This is sort of what, like Clara mentioned, of many people going to college in Russia. Many kids, almost every kid goes to high school now, and many, many kids are going to college. But what basically is going on is people come out and don't get exactly the job that they wanted, or they're discovering basically that the return to education is not quite what they had been told. Okay, and so one common thing that we ask, for example, in development economics, which a colleague of the team here, Lance Pritchett, has, or a former colleague, has written much about, is what has education done for growth? And I think something we often need to ask, or what has education done for jobs, let's say? What do jobs do for education? Because if people don't see that, you know, there is a job coming down for me if I actually go to school, then things are not going to work well. Let me say two lines about work I've done trying to explain why this is. So basically, if I look at a country like Chile, I would say Chile is doing exactly everything that should be in this pyramid, and yet the president is shocked because he says, now I have a big problem here and I'm not sure what happened exactly. Okay? So one of the issues that the final issue I want to emphasize, and let me just go to, is I've thought about this in theoretical work with Bentley McLeod, who spoke here yesterday. Let me just try to illustrate this quickly with one quote. What is it that basically happens if you just truly liberalize educational systems? There's going to be lots of stratification. Okay, there's an incentive for very selective schools to enter. And this gets back to the human agency issue that basically Matt Dean mentioned. It does not necessarily increase effort and the formation of human capital, because what basically happens is if jobs are allocated just by how an educational sector is stratified, it does not necessarily mean that people work hard. So for example, let's say that the way to get a good job in New York City in the financial sector is to get an undergraduate or graduate degree at Columbia University. Okay? And that you know, if you come to Columbia, you're basically signaling to Manhattan that you're a bright person, right? Because we're extremely selective. Then you might say, well, once I'm here, I don't really need to make a huge effort, right? And the effort, the like human agency part, the effort basically goes down. And so what a country needs to do basically is to structure both labor and educational markets such that there's a clear link between the fundamental, between if I make an investment, I'm going to get some type of job. And if I, you know, and likewise, basically those job, you know, the human capital that we form might actually contribute to basically generating more productive workers. If that link doesn't quite exist, okay, then there's basically going to be reasons for disappointment, just like Chile experienced. That's one type of disappointment. A different type of disappointment might be what we're seeing in the Middle East, of sort of like high youth unemployment, high unemployment of graduates, or, you know, we've been seeing that in the Middle East for a long time. Here in the U.S., we're seeing it distinctly over the past 3 or 4 years. If this goes on here, this is a problem, right? If people basically say, I can go to college, but I don't get a job, then that's going to be a real problem for human capital investment. Let me make one last point, that what this is basically saying is that there's going to be a role for market design
in school system structure, that basically the issue of saying, if I liberalize the bottom part of the pyramid and I liberalize the top part of the pyramid, everything is going to work well, is actually, in my view, at least from the point of view of human capital, inaccurate. That basically, if you want the bottom part of the pyramid to work, so that requires market design. For example, I don't have time because I'm basically out of minutes here, but I would say the way Chile organized its educational system and introduced competition was not the right way to do it. It could have been done better. Okay, so simply liberalizing there is not going to work. And then getting back to this report, the issue of how those jobs basically feed into the expectations of people is basically going to be very important. So the bottom line, I guess, is that human capital and the top thing are basically going to be very related, and I don't think that splitting them up necessarily and saying, well, you know, fundamentals are just fundamentals, so we're going to set them apart, is necessarily the way to go. But I think that the emphasis on jobs is very important for those of us interested in human capital, and I very much appreciated reading this excellent report. This is quick to say, but it's a colossal undertaking. I was quite impressed by how nicely written and how well summarized everything is. Thanks very much.
Great. Thanks to all of you for your insights and also for being respectful of the time, which I know is I don't take for granted. I'm going to open it up into the room for comments in a moment, but I first wanted to see if any of you had comments or questions for each other.
Question for Claire. So I very much enjoyed your presentations, the other ones, and I guess I wanted to comment on Claire's sort of methodological point, which I think is I'll say is fundamental, and maybe even more so with respect to where Claire was going in terms of just the difficulty of identifying I'll sort of say policy effects. And I think for the topics, or at least some aspects of the topics that are in the WDR, part of it is that the kind of firm level data sets, this isn't exact, all the data sets, so you know, there's an enormous number of household data sets out there for many, many countries, that many of which are in the public domain. For firm level data sets, they're sort of few and far between, and the WDR struggled with this, right? So they were kind of grabbing pieces, disparate pieces from lots of different places, and I think they did a pretty good job. But we're even in deeper water, right? Sort of say when that's the case. So for example, and I don't wanna, I've chatted with the WDR team in this. There's various places where the WDR team compares firm level moments. You could say even job creation and destruction moments, but productivity dispersion moments across countries. That's fraught with peril. Okay, in this context, we know. We kind of just know we need to get closer to some sort of diff and diff on, and not just diff and diff for anything, right. but variation where there's a lot of signal to noise. And for the firm level data sets, this is just methodological points, since you don't have access, it's pretty hard to kind of go do all the exploration. So I think that's a challenge here for jobs and productivity, is we don't have, you know, 100 countries worth of firm level data sets sitting up on the web, easy to get it. They're pocketed in various people, you know, you either have to get in, you know, crack the doors of the statistical agencies, or, you know, various people have gotten access over the years. So I think it's a fundamental point, and maybe particularly for the kind of topics that are in the jobs report.
No, I totally agree with this, and also, you know, the quality of the data, especially at the firm level, is a big issue. So there is an issue for, again, with respect to transition economies and the data that I work with, I always have to question, so what actually firms report? And having a lot of relatives working as accountants, they tell me basically all the mechanisms, how actually this data is created. And then I say, okay, I'm an academic, so I'm using the data to estimate the policy effects. And that's a question, what I'm actually observing, how much of that is actually true measures of productivity, and how much is it just a behavioral response to, in order to avoid tax payments, social security, et cetera. But even I would say in the household level data, it's also a fundamental problem. So you might think about this, that we have a lot of representative household surveys, but for the policy analysis, we need actually representation not only for the country itself. We need to find the heterogeneous effect at different points of distribution. So we need enough variation over time within different groups to be able to actually get these kinds of effects. And just simply having a representative sample is not enough. It has to be quite enough sample to be able to look within group variation and across time variation.
Okay.
Do you have any questions from the room?
Okay. Two very brief questions. If you can just tell us about why you think long-term decline in job destruction and job creation in the U.S. Is the U.S. market becoming less competitive and less creative destruction in that sense? And then, Miguel, I'm curious about what you think Chile should have done differently to improve outcomes.
So I'll be brief partly because I'll say I'm studying it, but I don't feel like I fully know. But I can tell you what partly it is and what it's not in terms of the declining pace of creative destruction. So one thing that it is, and this is not an explanation, but it tells you where to look. There's a long-term decline in the pace of business startups in the United States. So what's going on is the age composition of U.S. businesses has become older, and very much because we have a secular decline in the pace of new businesses. Now, that could make you very nervous, okay, to the extent that the U.S., you view the U.S. as this entrepreneurial economy. And indeed, you could say it's lost its kind of entrepreneurial mojo, all right? But there are potentially more benign explanations of that. I mean, that's a fact, and the question is why that's going on. Demographics gets a part of it, and so you can actually get a little piece of it, people have found, with demographics. We're actively studying to see whether, and this is, you could say it's related to what Clara's talking about methodologically, you know, can we find variation in the data on kind of the policy dimension to identify whether the startup, why startup rates are falling? And it does turn out, by the way, that the startup rates are falling differentially across U.S. states. So we're trying to use the kind of variation, trying to find the right variation and the right policies to be able to identify effects is not easy. So I'll stop there. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, thanks. That's a good question, and I think that the way to answer that question is to get back to the point that John makes, which is in any industry, in order to make things better, ultimately what you want is for the higher productivity firms to grow and, you know, for the lower productivity firms not to grow as much or even to disappear. In the educational industry, it's exactly the same thing. You basically want to identify high productivity suppliers and know who they are. Now, there then the question becomes, how do you identify what is a high productivity school that can produce lots of human capital? And secondly, what does the market do about that? And I think that the problem Chile had, and that what I might have done different, basically, yesterday it was said that labor is not a usual factor of production. I think that the educational industry is not a usual industry in the following way. It is hard for us as consumers to basically look at different firms and say, this is a more productive firm versus that one. Universities like Cornell or like Columbia, let's use a higher education example, it's hard to tell if they're very productive, like if we're all very good teachers, or we just get good inputs, which is we get good students, right? And so for the consumer, it's basically very hard to tell that. I think what Chile basically did wrong is it created, it introduced competition, which is good, but it basically let competition come in a way in which firms could basically make a reputation just by choosing students, right? So I can look good by choosing students well, as opposed to actually becoming more productive at teaching, right? The way I would have designed it, just to be brief, is something more like the charter school system here in the U.S. or the Swedish voucher system, which is to say, if you want to open a for-profit school, that's great because we want lots of competition. But for example, you might have to take kids randomly, right? So if you actually can teach, if you actually can produce human capital and show me, as opposed to I'm going to just let you coast by choosing students, and I think that basically created bad incentives and did exactly the opposite of what John wants, which is basically identify high productivity firms, let them grow, let them thrive, and so on and so forth.
Hi, I'm Marty Chen from the Harvard Kennedy School and the WeGo Network. A point about data. I agree that we don't have data on firms, but I would also add we really don't have data on labor force either. And if 50, 60, 70, 80, 90% of the labor force in countries is informal, we're not measuring that well. And if 85% of manufacturing units in India are informal, we're not capturing it. So there really is a public good challenge here, and it's not just with the firms. And let me give you an example from India, a country that I probably know best of any country. We work closely with the National Statistical Organization of India and introduced a module on urban informality and a module on rural informality in the 1999-2000 round of the NSSO. It found 35% more economic units in the country than the previous round. The next round, those two modules were dropped because the economists who advised the National Sample Survey Organization were so caught up in the debate on how much poverty there is in India, they wanted to put all the extra spending into the income expenditure survey, which is separate from the labor force survey. And they were on record as saying, what does it matter that we know anything about the low-income workers, right? And so we have a challenge. I have a challenge to labor economists that in the rush to be able to model the policy impacts of policies on the labor market, we're not taking the time out to really improve the labor force and the other economic statistics. And whenever I talk to labor economists or other economists about the informal economy, they say, give me a data set. And I say, well, we happen to know that the WeGo network is one of the few informed users of data that are asking the national statistical offices to improve data, and are also asking the donor community to have a coherent policy, because wherever we go, there's a flavor of the month household survey being done, which does not lead to coherence. So I think the data challenge is huge, and we really do not understand what's happening in firms or in the workforce. Thank you.
Do you have any responses to that?
No, we agree.
We agree.
Seconded, thirded, and fourth. If whoever wants to make a comment, please just come up to the microphone and identify yourself.
Thank you. Alfonso Diaz. This question is to Miguel. Is there any bright spot in Latin America? I recall, when was that, 2 or 3 years ago, you were part of the America's Society quarterly issue was devoted to education. More specifically, Brazil. I know a little bit about Brazil. They have a huge gap between what they spend in higher education and even if it is delivered as a public in public universities, because of the tuition. That is the pricing, to speak like an economist. It actually deepens the income gap. Could you comment on that?
Sure. So, are there bright spots in Latin America? Certainly, and I think that there are places that are basically. So let me mention Chile once again briefly, and then say something about Brazil. But there are things that Chile has done correctly, and in terms of higher education and education, and has done better than the rest of Latin America. And I think that one thing that it has done well is basically to give a larger role to national tests. Okay, so this is once again something that is something that the market doesn't automatically do, and it has basically is using national tests in a way to mediate entry into higher education. So both Brazil and Chile are rare examples for most Latin America, where a very systematic admission process is basically used into higher education. I think that this produces generally good incentives in the system, and to the extent that Chile has had some improvement in testing, I would think that this is part of the source. Now, let me mention briefly Brazil, which has an excellent higher educational sector. Is that one thing that basically I think Latin America faces, and this gets back to the social cohesion aspect of the report, is high income inequality, right? So there are people
you know, for better or for worse, some people are basically getting jobs which give very high income, and people are getting jobs that don't. I think that, you know, that is a challenge. I think that the way Brazil has handled this personally, I think, might be better, in the sense that the higher education sector is highly subsidized, but it's also more controlled, meaning that the slots are controlled, right? And now this might even deepen inequality. But in a way, Chile has done the opposite thing, which is to say maybe more of like a US approach, which is to let the market create more universities and more colleges. Now, what has ended up happening is that, like in the US, you get a lot of for-profit entry, and you're going to get lower quality schools getting lower quality people. This might not be bad. I mean, it's more human capital if you count human capital by years of schooling, but it could create disappointment, which I think is what Chile is basically facing. Now, you might say this is great, but it's clearly not great if it basically leads to some sort of instability. Chile has been able to create jobs for that great expansion, but I think that there's some nervousness as to exactly how many jobs and what type of jobs would be created. So I don't think anyone's nailing it, and part of it is, you know, maybe we should take some fault as economists. At least in my understanding of the literature, we don't know exactly what the right design would be. This is actually something that I don't think we've worked enough on, what an optimal design would be. Apologies for the long answer.
My name is Jim Dingman. I wanted to ask a question about salary creation. If one looks here in New York, and I'm going down to Harlem right now to help a group, Harlem United, dealing with legislation right now, usually they estimate you need a wage of $17 to $20 an hour to adequately be able to sustain oneself in New York. Now, obviously, when you let the free market decide, that's not in their objective interest to pay people those kind of wages. And so I'd like to hear what this WDR study or you all think about that issue, the creation of decent living wages for people in these economies in general, which obviously we know is not going on.
It's a really hard question, and so I don't know. So maybe I'm just doing my panelist thing. I'll filibuster for a second while they think of a good response.
You can take more than a second.
So they paid me for this. They said, you know, I actually think that I'll say here's what I think the data show. It's a fundamental question, obviously. Here's what I think the data show in terms of wages and productivity at the micro level. High productivity firms pay higher wages. That's what goes on in the cross section. So it's got to be the case that the economic environment is one in which we are moving resources to high productivity firms, or you're just not going to have high wages. Now, it's more complicated than that, but I would say, in developed and developing economies, we see that's very strong correlation in the data. So when I think about good jobs for economic development, I worry about exactly the kind of question that you're about, and I know wages and productivity aren't always just simply equalized. I'm not just saying worlds work so workers get paid their marginal product. I know better than that. But I do see this very strong covariation. So in some sense, when I worry about your question, I worry about productivity first. At the micro level is the point. And can I say the evidence that I've talked about suggests that micro and macro productivity are very tightly linked. And so that's the challenge, is indeed, do you have an environment where high productivity firms can both start up and thrive and grow that will create high wage jobs? That was my filibuster.
Great answer.
I can say something. So I agree with that answer. Let me just add one element also, specifically with respect to Harlem and getting back to human capital. Basically, what you basically want is for people to say, if I go to school, then something's going to happen for me in the job market. Right? Now, this is going to be impossible unless there are higher productivity firms growing if you want to get, say, the wage to $17, $18. And there's no high productivity activity. At the same time, you want people to be able to invest in skills to prepare themselves for such jobs, right? Now, if you look at Harlem, or you know, lots of neighborhoods in New York City, and this is not unlike many neighborhoods I can think of in Latin America, for example, you're going to find that the young population sort of says, I see no path, right? I have been put in a place, and put in a set of schools that are identified as bad. I'm identified as a loser, for lack of a better term. And so investing in my human capital is not really something that I see as attractive. You know, maybe rather than try to stick in school and get good grades, I should do something else. You know, let's speak as if this were TV. I might be able to sell drugs and make money because there's other opportunities. And so basically getting people engaged. So unless we get both growth of high productivity firms and unless we get people engaged in sort of saying, I want to have better human capital to someday be able to get that job, and unless we can make that link, that's easier said than done, obviously, but you know, I think that this is one of the issues that we face in countries that are stratified, in cities that are stratified, where basically people say the type of neighborhood I live in, the type of school I go to says something about my future, and this is, I think, a big challenge in Latin America as in New York City, at least for the regional perspective.
Actually, I actually had a question for John. One of the comments that you had made was about the importance of looking at a broad spectrum of policies when you're talking about allocating jobs to the highest efficiency use. Talked about credit and trade policies as well. But since we've had so much conversation on the panel about education and human capital, I wanted to see if you wanted to put in your 2 cents worth on the role of early age education through primary and secondary, but also do you have any thoughts on retraining and higher education?
Well, can I hand that question off? No, I've been engaged in this kind of discussion, I'll say partly just a sign of age, and this is a topic I've been worrying about for some time. The connection, I'll say, between allocative efficiency, productivity, and reallocation, and the barriers for, I'll say, a very long time now. And so you'd think maybe I'd have better perspective, I've had the good fortune, I'd sort of say, to be able to talk to folks at the various international organizations, the World Bank in particular, but other international organizations about this. And I think what I'm always struck by is we don't have any shortage of the sort of policy prescriptions. I mean, we can give the 101 policy prescriptions, including the ones on the key role. I very much enjoyed the discussion on the critical role for human capital and education. And I know I think the WDR has had focal points on just this issue. And I agree that's fundamental. I think the hard part is 101 policy prescriptions. And so and then I'll come back to sort of the themes I sort of brought up. So we say, okay, do these 101 things. Of course, you can't do all those at the same time, but do these 101. Get your education system and your retraining system. Go open up, make your labor markets flexible. Make your product markets flexible. Reduce the barriers to sort of entry and exit. And you do all these things. Can I say what countries worry about? Rightfully so. Is this, I'll say, huge decoupling of creation of, we're going to open up markets, and what we're going to discover is all of our businesses can't compete. They're going to all shut down. And we haven't reformed the rest of the economy, so nobody's going to want to create jobs in our economy either. And I think we've all been to countries just like that. I was sort of fortunate enough to give talk in the Republic of Georgia earlier this year. I'd say, I'm not trying to pick on the Republic of Georgia, I don't know if anybody's here, they look like an economy just like that. They had a huge industrial sector because Stalin had wanted to put lots of manufacturing there. They have essentially no manufacturing sector now. So they had an enormous amount of destruction, and they haven't figured out how to create the business environment. And we could sort of say, okay, well, what's the policy prescription? Is it the education system? Is it whatever? Actually, their education system, at least in the major cities, isn't so bad. It's I'll go ahead and say the university population I talked to was incredibly bright and talented, and partly the reason I was there is we have some very good graduate students from Georgia at Maryland. I'm sure that they're here in Columbia as well. So again, I think the hard part, and as I read the WDR report, is I know that the World Bank's always in this business of, we're supposed to somehow take these documents, and then there's the folks on the mission teams are supposed to hit the road with this, right? And so the question is, what's the playbook? And you guys are better at that than me, so.
Like, did you guys have any thoughts on that, or?
So the only comment on this, I would like to say, so it's hard to say about how the human capital affects job creation, because I think we know, like, generally there is a positive returns to human capital, there is a positive correlation between human capital and productivity and wages. But I think if we go to specific examples, like in my case when I was presenting it, so it's not only about the amount of human capital that matters. It's the type of human capital. It's the quality of human capital. So if, again, so for example, today in Russia, so 80% of schooling age population are in school. So the question is, in a tertiary education, so it's a college level education. So what kind of schools are those? So then we realize, you know, there are some that is just like with one or two teachers, got a very small private colleges where people pay tuitions and don't get a very high level of education. So I think, so heterogeneity is very important. And then they all come with the same, not the same degree, but the same level of education on the job market. So now the employer faces the fact that almost all country now is highly educated. So how are they going to differentiate between them? So which leads to the huge heterogeneity in returns to college quality. So you see the sorting processes. You see the people sort themselves into better college qualities. So you have a huge, again, heterogeneity in the average entrance scores across students. So and of course, this is going to lead later to the mismatch between the skills that people acquired. So they're all economists. Now I read the statistics. So if you take all the Russian economists that have been trained and you put them together around the equator, so you can cover the world four times. So how many economists you need? How many economists you need for the country like Russia? Yes, it's big, but still, you know. So I mean, so there's an issue that needs to be taken care of. It's not about only the general concept about how human capital affects jobs, but what types of human capital and the quality. Mm-hmm. Did you have any?
I think there are some questions. Okay. Yeah, I don't have.
Yeah, go ahead.
So it's not a question. It's an observation, and it's an issue, which actually Jan and I have talked about and so on. It's to do with what's the nature of the market structure for labor in developing countries. And not just standard labor market stuff, but for example, in the self-employed context, the market structure of in terms of the markets that the women who do the self-employed stuff sell their products to. The basic model that economists work with is the competitive market model. That's the thing that kicks into our minds. Whenever we do any policy analysis, we immediately put it through the competitive market framework. This tariff changes, this goes through, et cetera, and we get a conclusion. Or we introduce a minimum wage, it passes through a competitive labor market, of course it's gonna cause unemployment, et cetera. And I think it's an empirical question as to whether actually market structures in developing country contexts are or are not competitive, do or do not comply with the standard textbook model stuff. And I think there's a tremendous disconnect between the way that economists, the standard model that economists have in their mind, and the standard model, if one can call it that, that civil society had in its mind, was wherever they turn, they see non-competitive behavior. They see the big trader. They see the people with their big trucks who actually determine the price for the farmers who are selling the stuff on the streets and so on. So then when we say, if you do this, then there'll be a pass-through of the prices, et cetera, and they say, no, no, actually, there won't be a pass-through. It's going to be absorbed by this monopsony power in this thing. So I think it's an empirical question, and we really need to be able to address that. And frankly, I don't see that much in the way of empirical work, because the standard model that we always use is it's a competitive type setting. Anyway, this is one topic that Jan and I have been thinking about as being for our next conference in this area, really getting empirically at market structure in labor markets and in related markets in the developing country context.
So I think that's a... It's a very well taken point, but can I say, and I don't want to say that that looking at the productivity and size distribution is the be all and the end all. But let's take exactly your characterization of what goes on in lots of developed economies. That will be precisely an economy where the size and the productivity distribution will be highly distorted.
And so I think that that's actually, that's partly why we need the data to be able to track the full size distribution and the full productivity distribution. But then this comes back again to the very nice comment we had about missing data, right? Because so many of us, I'm in this business of trying to put together as many firm level data sets as I possibly can, and so Clara and so on, a number of people in this room that I know are doing this. Oftentimes, as the point was made earlier, we only have the formal sector firms. And indeed, the distortions you're talking, the distortions we see, I mean, by the way, the WDR went after this as best as they possibly could. They clearly recognized this, and it's the whole business of informal and informal firms. And what part of those are we picking up as sort of the point is. And I would say if we could get the kind of the right data for both households and businesses, and so that we could look at this size productivity in a kind of a comprehensive way, and there. I'm going to forget the particular exercise in the WDR that does just this. It sort of takes the standard formal data. So I'm sure the WDR team's going, yeah, we did this. They took sort of the standard data, and then they did their best to try to add in the missing data to sort of see what the exercise are. And I think that's a chance to kind of go after the kind of things you're about. And last point, I think is related to this. So I've emphasized just enormous productivity differences across businesses, and that's why you've got to worry so much about this. That's especially true of these micro enterprises. When we get any data, you could say it's incredibly noisy, whatever, the dispersion is especially high amongst that group. So it really matters a lot, indeed, you know, who's surviving and who's growing in that group. If nobody's growing, which is sort of part of the problem, and you kind of even described why, That's going to be bad for that country, right? Because indeed, I mean, can I say in the United States, there actually are an enormous number of micro businesses, most of which don't go anywhere. But the U.S. gets an enormous amount of gains out of the right tail of the productivity and job growth distribution, particularly amongst these micro young businesses. Just disproportionate. So you could, I don't know that this is not the policy prescription, but potentially you could go after exactly the kind of things you're talking about if we had the right data sort of tracking these kind of distortions and the kind of non-competitive behavior you're talking about.
I just want to highlight a couple of takeaways that I have from this group, and then I'll let each of you may have a sort of closing word. Something Miguel said really struck me. It was raising the question of what do jobs do for education? We so often hear that question posed the other way around, and I'm it makes me think of Peter Thiel's controversial offer of $100,000 to kids to start a business instead of to go to school. So I think it's a really important way of thinking about things. Clara's point about data and informality, obviously we've given a lot of attention to, but I think that's really the big takeaway from her discussion is that we need much better data to be able to make good policy prescriptions. What I took away from John is that we really need a more holistic approach. We need to look not just at job creation, but also job destruction. There's often a big mismatch between the two of them. And if we want to get that right, we need to look at both together. Did you have one more question there?
Before the panel responds, can you give a few more inputs from the team?
Yes,
yeah.
Absolutely.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Thanks a lot. We are really grateful because you made up for a very rich session for us. And of course, we cannot change the report now. And perhaps that's a good thing.
I'm sure no. From your perspective it is.
but I want just to add a few points that came to my mind, and I'm sure to the mind of the entire team when listening to you. And let me go in a way, speaker by speaker, panelist by panelist, on some of the points that came up. On labor policies, I think, please don't get us wrong. We are not saying that labor policies don't matter. We say the cliffs are really serious. And we have examples of countries off the cliff. And nobody will dispute, I guess, that either the Industrial Disputes Act of India is an example of a policy way off the cliff. So that's not the point. But even listening to your presentation, several things that came to mind. You say, well, there is an attenuation bias in the data, a zero bias. But then you show the disaggregated results that show, well, it's not zero across the board, which is precisely the point we make, is that there is a lot of redistribution. There are winners and losers from these policies. But what is the aggregate effect? You said policymakers don't care and academics care about labor policy. And I'm not sure that's the way in developing countries. I would say when we go from international organizations and we tell them, is your stupid labor policies, they say, are you sure? And you take these investment climate assessments and you ask them, is labor policy your problem? And it will come way down the list. So I'm not sure that the portrait of academics knowing and policymakers not knowing is totally what we are facing. And then I think you made a point that I think is very relevant, which is I thought in your informality at the intensive margin in Russia, how changes in minimum wages affect what people report rather than what people do. I think in developing countries where we have a lot of these margins, degrees of freedom to adjust because of very imperfect institutions, you see a lot of that. And so you can expect more second order effects than first order effects because you have one variable on which you adjust. Even in the case of the Industrial Dispute Act of India, we went to lengths to see whether we could see spikes in the distribution of firms by size or anything else at the points where the law has a threshold, like 50, 100 workers. And that becomes very difficult. I suspect it's just because these people know how to evade it. It doesn't make it a good policy at all. In fact, one of the points is that just evading is a horrible response, policy response to a serious problem. But I think that the point we were trying to make with the plateau and cliffs is I didn't see it as completely inconsistent with what you described. On firm dynamics, John, and it was great to have you in our panel and to discuss with you many times. I think the two things that we come up with is, or three things. One, as you said, is not lack of job creation destruction. We see it everywhere, so that doesn't seem to be the problem. The distribution is not what we believe, because that's the second point, because of all the little ones. But I think we have a few comparisons that resemble what you said about the U.S. You said, well, I cannot tell why this is so, but I see a decline in startups. And what we saw, even if we cannot tell why this is so, especially there is, I think, a very nice comparison between Ghana and Portugal firm dynamics, is that firms are born large in developing countries. It suggests that there is something about privilege, connections, state protection, whatever. And small firms never grow in developing countries. You have very few of those that cross. So one can say, I don't know why this is, but there seems to be something in the firm dynamics that is coming up. And finally, to Miguel, I think we don't have a disagreement at all with the point you made. In fact, we were going to call basic human capital the one on the fundamentals, but you probably saw there is this question on skills or jobs, which comes first, which is precisely the point. Among the conversations we had along the way, we had one that for us was very instructive with Paul Romer. Say, well, basically, you know what Estasia did that was right, is put everybody to work. Because even basic skills like punctuality, reliability, the kind of things, you can acquire them through work. And we have this very nice example of Bangladesh, of how having garment factories nearby affects schooling decisions. So I think the one of the questions goes very much in line. I agree that by slicing it that way, it looks like human capital is only at the bottom. But we tried in a way, perhaps unsuccessfully, to do exactly the point you make.
If I may, just before the panel responds, can I make an attempt to push you a little bit in the framework and up kind of the pyramid to a certain degree? And just following up on what Martin said, Clara, so these typologies, for us, they're not exclusive. So Russia, for example, would be in a resource-rich jobs challenge, as well as probably formality to a certain degree formalizing or urbanizing. So if you take your research on Russia, and if you think through a couple of the ways the employment protection legislation or minimum wages work, what would be for you kind of the top of this pyramid, in the sense, what would be a policy which would bring out these good jobs for development, in the sense that these are policies where the impact goes beyond the individual?
Running out of time, so.
Yeah, okay, good. And then to John, in the same way, the priorities here for us was, in the productivity sense, very much agglomeration effects, so positive impacts of urbanization. From your data, do you see this link between city policies at a broader level and productivity developments?
Great.
And lastly, to Miguel, the priority here are knowledge spillovers for us, so how jobs and firms actually impact on each other in a positive way. From the skill-building literature, do we have something which we can say what are good policies in that sense?
Great. If I could ask you just to do 1 minute each, sort of, you know, response to that and final comment, because we're at the end of the hour.
I'll be really brief. Maybe I'll just say I agree with both sets of comments. I'm not going to be able to go after your big, I think it's a very interesting question, the agglomeration. I did want to come back to this issue about whether there really is a plateau, or we just haven't figured out what's going on with labor policies completely. And I'm sympathetic with Clara's perspective. I think this is not just true for labor policies, but her methodological point is a first order point, I sort of say, across the board. Trying to find kind of the appropriate variation, can I say, in the left and the right-hand side for identification is a real challenge here. I think on labor policies, that's partly where the studies are all over the map. I would say when indeed, I'll say I think that the identification is clean, we find variation where it really should cut. You almost sort of said that, by the way, and even your example of the thresholds. And indeed, there's more there. So I think it's taking a step back, I think it's a mistake to sort of say, oh, because there's such a plethora of studies that we, you know, they're all over the map. Well, I think they're all over the map because of the difficult identification problems.
Clara?
Yeah, so I actually also sympathetic with this view. So I think that's very, very, I think that's what the reason why we actually identify very strong effects at the cliffs, because the changes are so dramatic. So when, for example, Russia went through the progressive tax schedule to flat tax schedule, it was a huge change. So, and that's where you can really see the change. So when you can identify the productivity effect and the income effect and the evasion effects. But when we try to identify very small changes, so that's the issue. But the issue I still, so you know you're saying that it does not mean that the labor market policies do not matter. But when you look at the aggregate, the research that have been done, they're all over the place. They don't give really kind of intuition what's actually working and what's not working. So I think, still, there is still a lot of work to be done in empirical identification of the policies. That's for sure. I don't think I would be able to answer to the question what policy that would be good for development from the Russia perspective, because it's just very complicated. There are a lot of issues related. So the Russia is a very special case in the sense that the employment actually is pretty stable. So the unemployment rate did not change dramatically in response to the recession period. I think in Russia case, there are a lot of comes on the wage side. So on the wage side, on the informal economy, on how much income is hidden, even like, for example, violation of wage contract is very common. Even during the recession period, the wage arrears, non-payment of wages went up, for example. And that's a question, is it good jobs for development or not good jobs? So I think that's actually I need to think about to answer to this question more. So it's a little bit more complicated.
Thank you. And Miguel, wrap up.
Sure, let me just close by bringing back the phrase that basically Michelle said, which is what can human capital do for jobs, and what can jobs do for human capital? I realize and I appreciate the two last comments. This is something that is covered in the report, but I think it's something that can be covered more directly. You know, just as a matter of thought, basically. In this question, like what is the interrelation between these two things, I think John is right that in many areas we do have recipes and we do have knowledge of how to do things. I think that in the area of how these two things relate, jobs and education and jobs, we actually don't have a lot of what, like if you told me now you can run a country, right, exactly what would happen,
I don't think that we have such a good playbook for that. And this, you know, I think that part of the issue, part of the reason these things are often divorced is that we don't really have a good recipe on either. You know, certainly on the education side, I should say that. I know less about jobs, but.
Great. Thank you. Well, please join me in thanking our fantastic panel. Thanks.